Okay.
Hello, everybody. Thank you all for coming tonight. I am so honored to be sitting here next to Margot. As many of you know, she is the winner of Pulitzer Prize in Criticism. And for years, she was the book and art critic at Newsweek and the New York Times. Her previous book on Michael Jackson was highly acclaimed. And near and dear to my heart, she now teaches writing at Columbia University. I was just talking with my friend Jill Cowan, whose mother-in-law is from Chicago, about the lost art of writing and how we need to teach this next generation how to chronicle our stories. So I'm thrilled that you're now teaching young children, young students.
Relatively
young students.
Young
yes. She's also my neighbor in the West Village,
yes.
Although it took Sue Ellen to bring us together. And most recently, of course, she won the National Book Critics Circle Award for her autobiography, Negroland, a Memoir, from which she will read right now.
All right. Thank you, Dawn. Dawn is one of those bright young things my generation saw coming up. And thank you, Sue Ellen. Glad to be here. I was taught to avoid showing off. I was taught to distinguish myself through presentation, not declaration, to excel through deeds and manners, not showing off. But isn't all memoir a form of showing off? In my Negroland childhood, this was a perilous business. Negroland is my name for a small region of Negro America where residents were sheltered by a certain amount of privilege and plenty. Children in Negroland were warned that few Negroes enjoyed privilege or plenty, and that most whites would be glad to see them returned to indigence, deference, and subservience. Children there were taught that most other Negroes ought to be emulating us, when too many of them, out of envy or ignorance, went on behaving in ways that encouraged racial prejudice. Too many Negroes, it was said, showed off the wrong things, loud voices, brash and garish ways, their gift for popular music and dance, for sports, rather than for the humanities and sciences. Most white people were on the lookout, we were told, for what they called these basic racial traits. But most white people were also on the lookout for a too bold display by us of other kinds of accomplishments, their kind of accomplishments, their privilege and plenty, what they considered their racial traits. You were never to act undignified in their presence, but neither were you to act flamboyant. Showing off was permitted, even encouraged, only if the result reflected well on your family, their friends, and your collective ancestors. So here I am, age 4, at a children's club talent show in the wings of an auditorium with other excited Jack and Jillers. Recognition, all right. While we are being gently and firmly shushed, I break away and stride onto the stage. My 5-year-old friend is performing her recitation. I step in front of her, turn around, and tell the adult seated at the piano, "Keep playing that music." He obeys. I turn back to the audience and do my notion of a dance for a few minutes. I hear the adults exclaim and laugh appreciatively. I've charmed them because I have a reputation for being bright and spirited. Even my friend's mother is indulgent. I don't recall my friend's reaction. Why should I? I was out to obliterate her. I could take adult indulgence too far when my need to shine blurred my sense of the occasion. At a dinner party not long after, where the adults were more interested in each other than in children, I waited for a break in their talk, then announced, "Sometimes I forget to wipe myself." The laughter came, but only after a short silence, and I saw the guests looking at each other before they looked at me. I realized I was being more tolerated than appreciated, and it came to me that repeating such a statement, showing off in public what's done in private, would always bring reproof. So I grew. And as I grew, I learned that in the world beyond family and family friends, your mistakes, bad manners, poor taste, and excess of high spirits could put you, your parents, and your people at risk. All of you could be designated at a stroke and for life, vulgar, coarse, and inferior. Clever of me to become a critic. we critics scrutinize and show off to a higher end for a greater good. Our manners, our tastes, our declarations are welcomed. Superior for life, except when we're not. Except when we're dismissed or denounced as envious or petty, as derivatives and dependents by nature, second class for life. That's the generic version of the story. Here's the specific version, the Midwestern mid-century story of a little girl, one of two born to an attractive couple, pleased with their lives and achievements, wanting the best for their children and wanting their children to be among the best, to be successful professionally and personally, and to be happy. Children always find ways to subvert while they're busy complying. This child's method of subversion, she would achieve success, but she would treat it like a concession she'd been forced to make. For unto whomsoever much is given, of her shall be much required. She came to feel that too much had been required of her. She would have her revenge. She would insist on an inner life regulated by despair. The story she constructs is this. There was a girl, once upon a time and in your time. She embraced her life up to a point, then rejected it, and from that rejection have come her difficulties. She comes to feel that her life has gone wrong. Some of this is the usual thwarted ambition. She's good, quite good, at her work, at her profession. She should have been outstanding. She is by some measures, but she's not phenomenal. She knows she's privileged to be a writer. She should love what she does, but she doesn't. Much of the time, she convinces herself that she hates writing. About love and sex, she should have been adventurous, less wary. How does someone like this, so often ashamed of what she is, always ashamed of what she lacks, write about herself? I'm going to change my tone now. I think it's too easy to recount unhappy memories when you write about yourself. You bask in your own innocence. You revere your grief. You arrange your angers at their most becoming angles. I don't want this kind of indulgence to dominate my memories. And I was taught you don't tell your secrets to strangers. Certainly not secrets that expose error, weakness, failure. Nothing is just personal. And all readers are strangers. Right now, I'm overwhelmed by trying to calculate, imagine what these readers might expect of me, reject, demand, deny, how this one will insist as that one resists. So I'm going to read several sections that I hope will give a sense of very different moods and tones in the book. Sit on the stairs with Denise and me as our parents give one of their parties. The music on the record player might be Ellington, the suave heft of In a Mellow Tone, or Errol Garner's Autumn Leaves, rhapsodic, then antic and sly. Jewelry glistens, so does the ice in cocktail glasses. Women lean in to have their cigarettes lit. Their voices run along the treble scale, and the men, the Arthur Prysock baritones with its undulating southernness, the northern leading man diction of Billy Eckstein, the patter and murmur of Nat King Cole, standard to blues English and back again, like Joe Williams. Two of the handsomest men spot us and insist we come to the bottom of the stairs to be kissed on the cheek. Everett White with his rich brown skin, his dimples, his white hair with its tiny crisp waves. Ed Wimp, ivory pale with keen features and straight dark hair. The Basie band strides through corner pocket. I settle back on the stairs, just below Denise, pressing my glasses against the banister. I was around 10. When my great uncle Lucius resumed his life as a Negro. Our Negro land friends looked as if they belonged to every group then classified as Negro, Caucasian, Asian, Latin, or Middle Eastern. Nearly everyone at my school looked white, but that was because nearly everyone was white. Negro students were mostly varied and distinct shades of brown. My three special friends in first and second grade all looked white. But when our mothers picked us up, Carolyn's and mine traded first names and comfortable greetings. Greetings with the mothers of J and A held neither banter nor first names. I sometimes heard mother telling daddy which school mothers were genuinely courteous, A's mother, which ones managed quietly, since it was a progressive school, to ignore her, and which ones, like J's mother, greeted her in a way that implied they wished to ignore her. A and J were definitely white. And once I started meeting Carolyn at family friend, not school friend events, a Jack and Jill party, a charity tea for Provident Hospital, I realized she belonged to Negroland. My euphemisms were becoming a bit torturous in those days. I don't remember ever saying Negro or white. I remember carefully saying my out-of-school friends and my school friends. But since some of my out-of-school friends were in school with me, this nomenclature did not serve my strategic evasions. I was clearly maneuvering to control my racial airspace. When Uncle Lucius stopped being white, my parents invited him to dinner. He had worked for decades as a traveling salesman, making periodic contact with his sisters and with cousins who looked white enough to meet him in segregated places when he came to town. Then he retired, and his retirement community was Negroland. Denise and I were told the basic story, and we greeted him politely. I watched him covertly all evening. He had the long Jefferson face, but I could find no physical sign that he was a Negro. His nose was blade straight, his lips sliver thin, his skin nearly as white as his hair. I told myself we have friends who look as white as Uncle Lucius, but I had always known them as Negroes. The word had kept its visual fluidity even as it acquired social obligations and political constraints. Now I was in free fall. Who and what are we Negroes when so many of us could be white people? I sat there and reasoned it out. If I am related to Uncle Lucius and I am visibly Negro, and Uncle Lucius is invisibly Negro and visibly white, suddenly the fact of racial slippage overwhelmed me. I was excited for days after. I knew something none of my white school friends knew. It wasn't just that some of us were as good as them. Even when they didn't always know it, some of us were them. Our cousin, Lillian Granberry Thompson, looked as if her portrait could hang in the Museum of the Confederacy. Lillian, she said, her father always told her, the best blood of Mississippi runs in your veins. She was a few years older than my father and chose to live as a fair-skinned Negro, passing for convenience when she wanted to patronize white-only shops and restaurants, reaping the little rewards, deference here, flattery there, often granted her by brown-skinned Negroes. She was a trusted conduit between the passers and the non-passers in Daddy's family. So many in my parents' world had relatives who'd spent their adult lives as white people of some kind. Avocational passing was lighthearted. Shopping at whites-only stores, getting deferential service at whites-only restaurants. You came home snickering. What fools these Nordics be. Passing for life stories were melodrama prompts. P lived as a Negro woman severed from her twin brother, who lived as a white man. N was the only family and a child in a family of eight to remain a Negro. H's brother had spent decades as a white man in a small English town. When his passworthy niece and I went to Europe the summer before we were college seniors, she visited him without me. Our mothers had discussed it beforehand. That was when Daddy told me about our cousin J.E., who'd passed as a successful white business and family man somewhere in the Midwest. I use initials to shield his public identity. His mother, my great-aunt Bessie, lived in Chicago. He would sometimes make contact with cousin Lil when he came to town. He had risen to the top or near top of an insurance company. She'd call other Negro relatives to set up visits. In my father's telling, the conversation was highly elliptical. Ronald, a childhood friend's in town and would like to see you. Can we come by your office tonight when you finished work? He even lowered his voice as he told the story. As I reconstruct it, night has fallen. The patients have gone home. The nurse and receptionist have gone home. There's a knock on the door. Cousin Lil enters first. She and my father kiss each other's cheeks. She is followed by J.E. Do they hug or shake hands? Shake hands, I imagine. Then, maybe a second's hesitation. They trade upper arm pats. How you doing? Fine, fine. Good to see you. If it's winter, talk of Chicago's cold will get them past the first awkwardness. If it's spring or summer, the heat leads to reminiscing about their southern childhood. What did you talk about? I asked. We talked about the old days, my father said, gazing past me. The old days when they were all Mississippians, with parents listed as mulattoes on the local census forms. Why did J.E. choose to visit Daddy? Had they been especially close? Or was this just one visit? I didn't ask. It was as if the visit, like J.E.'s life, had to be sealed off, as if further conversation would record what must stay hidden. Daddy told me that J.E.'s white sons had gotten wind of his ancestry when he died. Was that because his wife knew or suspected? Had there been a deathbed confession? Did the boys find incriminating documents when they went through his papers? How did they find a trail that led back to Rust, the Negro college he'd attended in Mississippi before transferring to the University of M up north? They were thwarted at Rust, told of a fire that had destroyed a number of school records, including their father's. Was this true? Or were school administrators old hands at putting white relatives off the scent of ex-Negroes? The sons persisted, somehow made their way to Chicago, where they presented themselves at their grandmother's, only to be rebuffed. How did they introduce themselves? Did they speak timidly, courteously, or gruffly and accusingly? Did they show her a photograph of the son and father who had thrown their patrimony into such doubt? I was told nothing, except that she gave the answer her son would have wished. I've never heard of that man, she said, and shut the door. Melodrama demands a climactic tableau. Tableau of resolve, the mother, defiant, preternaturally still, her voice a low, telltale throb, and of consternation. Let's have one son rearing back, shocked and confounded, the other turning away, hand to chest, every muscle conveying, thank God I've been reprieved. Melodrama recedes as my cousins resume their old lives or assume new ones. What had J.E. and his wife taught them about the Negro race? What did they know of Negroes before Negroness was thrust upon them? This will affect their decision. Together or apart, they can go on being white men who no longer have the privilege of taking themselves for granted. Or they can take on the touchy, hyper-conscious identity of light, bright, damn near white Negroes. Either way, no surface will ever be superficial again. As for Great Aunt Bessie, she had played her part as sacrificial mother. She, whose illicit standing, social, racial, sexual, choose your plot, demanded that she renounce all claims on her child. Traditional interpretations favor grief and stoic grandeur. Let's work with rage. Whatever she saw in their faces, fear, longing, confusion, disdain, Great Aunt Bessie's sentence was her revenge. It meant, none of you can claim or disclaim me now. I don't know your father anymore, and I don't know you. Whatever you want to know, I will keep hidden. And if you hope that my silence frees you to be white again, it does not. You've seen me, glimpsed his face in mine. You will never have a clean white slate again. You will never be able to forget that I may be the Negro grandmother who turned you away. I refused you. All speculation, dramatization, my great aunt's Negro grandchildren might know more, but I still don't have the nerve to ask. I sat with Cousin Lil at Great Aunt Bessie's funeral and brought up the story, hoping that death would loosen her tongue. She shook her head and touched my hand as one quiets a child about to do something inappropriate. "We're not supposed to talk about that," she said, and applied herself to conversation elsewhere. Uncle Lucius didn't come to our house again. I have a picture of him on my father's cabin cruiser, the Ballet High. He sits next to his sister. He looks content. She looks ebullient. My father told me that once he'd settle in, he began to telephone his Negro relatives and accuse them of neglecting him. Psychologically transparent, but he'd been a prickly white man too, said my father, regularly disturbing his own peace by getting into fights when he heard people mock or demean Negroes, as he inevitably did at the white bars and restaurants he invariably went to. "They don't talk about anything but us. What we do, how we look, how much they hate us," he told my father. But they must have talked about something else sometime. And the ordinary talk of ordinary white men must have been a comfort to Uncle Lucius in those early days. He could handle the nasty turns at first, till he couldn't. Then he'd fuss and fight and make himself a target of anger or suspicion. So when the time came to retire, he retired, retreated, and resettled among Negroes. But he wasn't really a Negro anymore. He was a former white man. And my parents looked down on him just a little, not because he'd passed, but because he'd risen no higher than traveling salesman. If you were going to take the trouble to be white, you were supposed to do better than you could have done as a Negro. Thank you.
I love it. I love that passage. I have a seventh grader, and we were teaching him how to highlight, and I kept saying, "Don't highlight the whole book, just the salient passage." But if you flip through my book, you would see the whole book is highlighted, so I'm not taking my own advice. So much of what you read brings to mind questions, and the first one has to be, you say that you don't even know if you like writing, and sometimes you feel hatred toward it, and in another passage you say that a memoir is a form of showing off. So how does someone who kind of feels that then go on to not just write a memoir, but a really beautiful one? How did you do that? How did you come to that?
How did I come to it? First of all, I'm not alone in hating writing oft times, as many writers do. And I've gone through periods where I've almost renounced it and am now came to be old enough to realize, well, no. You know, this is what I do, so to make my peace with it, I need to do it better. I need to try to do things I haven't done before. You're never perfect at what you do. I can look back at all kinds of criticism I wrote, you know, and wince at this line or that paragraph or that snobbish little assertion. But, you know, you know when you're repeating yourself. You know when your tricks are all there. And memoir terrified me because of the way I'd been brought up, you know, which really was, and I was not alone, this kind of, you know, injunction. Please, you know, everything you do in public is for the good or the advancement of the race. Don't tell our secrets. And I'd invested a great deal, partly as a critic. You know, to be a critic is in some way to perform omniscience, isn't it? So I had that going. So this seemed a risky and interesting thing to do, but also I really wanted to write about this world. And I didn't want to be a historian. I felt it's such a charged world and so many people know so little about it or have such, you know, strange reactions to it that I have to put myself on the line if I'm going to write about it. You know, it has to be. So I came to this thing that I called a personal / cultural memoir.
Right.
And that allowed me the space, you know, to go in and out of myself as center stage, then to recede into history at times.
Another thing that you do as a writer is there are passages that are in the first person.
Yeah.
And you're very vulnerable. And I think we can relate to them. There are passages that are in the third person, and there's almost this anthropological distance. Margot, the little girl with the glasses, who's a bit shy, who's trying to fit in. And then sometimes you even
who's
use the second person.
Dying to be popular, right?
Dying to be popular. And then sometimes you use the second person. And I was wondering how you decided which memory merited which person. Was that...
You know, at first, it was to some extent just instinct. You know, I would write a first draft in, you know, first person or third person. I tended towards third person if I was, you know, narrating a fairly substantial piece of information. There were certain things that really had to be revelatory and somewhat confessional. And I thought, well, I won't shy away from first person for some of those. Second person evolved partly because I really couldn't get what I thought was the proper emotional or analytical distance and insight. And then I realized as I was writing that a lot of this book is about these different masks that you put on. You know, you're the perfect little girl, you know, then you're the vulnerable little cute thing, and then, you know, you're the well-behaved representative of, you know, your family, your race. So those tenses, those shift actually served so all the social interactions were performances, were theater in some way.
It is no easy feat to do that, and yet you make it look so...
No. Many drafts.
Many drafts.
Many of them ugly.
There are at least three passages that I can recall where there's this tango between what the adult citizen of Negroland feels and the innocence that they're trying to protect, that their child has. And it's as if they know the storm is coming and they're contemplating when to break that seal of innocence for their children. And I'm gonna just read a couple of passages. You write, "I'm still obsessed with James Weldon Johnson's diagnosis of this condition, awaiting each colored child are cramping limitations and buttressed obstacles in addition to those that must be met by youth in general. Some parents try to spare their children this bitter knowledge as long as possible. Less sensitive parents, those maimed by their own bitterness, drive it into their child from infancy on." And you come back to that idea. And I know that part of the reason I love Martha's Vineyard is there is this sense of paradise for my child or my children, that we can preserve Eden, if you will. Mm-hmm. But there's this sense also that at some point you have to tell them there's this darker world out there, that it's full of racism, and even your privilege and your access won't protect you. Is that something that you felt your parents grappling with as a kid, or even only with the adult perspective and the lens of adulthood are you able to see that?
It's a very tricky business, what any of us as children are perceiving. I think one is taking in often moods, you know, quick changes, sudden anxieties. You know, my friend in the front row is nodding. When on the surface, all the things that are being said, you know, are perfectly pleasant and nice. And I think now that I picked up, you know, when we would say be going to a white restaurant that had just started to accept black people, or when we were first going to Saks and Bonwits on the north side, you know, which you went to a little after if you were black, after you went to Marshall Field's downtown. I now realize that though my mother would perform perfectly, you know, maybe her voice in telling us, you know, to behave well or not to talk too loudly, things that a parent just might say, or stop grabbing all those gloves, you know, there'd be a little more insistence. Sometimes all children overhear, you know, as I write there, I would sometimes overhear mother talking about the parents at my school, University of Chicago Lab School, whom she liked and felt, you know, were courteous and warm, and those who weren't. So I think, you know, a psychiatrist told me recently that children are also not only reacting to, you know, the parents separately, but they're reacting to this entity that is the mother and the father. And it occurs to me in terms of this, you know, race conundrum, the child is responding to these two sets of tensions, experiences, and modulations of what they're going to tell. And you forget that your parents have their own history, which they have to negotiate.
Absolutely. I will say that another passage in the book, many of the passages are as beautiful to contemplate as they are devastating. And there was one passage, I want to set it up, and if you wouldn't mind just reading from it. Your sister, you and your sister are asleep, and two children, Caucasian girls, come and play on the swing set. And Margot's mother has to tell them, the girls are sleeping, can you come back? And if you would read from that, I'll come back with my question.
Okay, I will. Yes, we used to go up and take, you know this, you'd be put up in bed for a nap every afternoon. These little girls, who were the last little white girls in our neighborhood, would come over when we were asleep. And my mother, would have to say, when she stepped onto the porch, there was, Mrs. Jefferson watched as the swings began to move. Then she stood and straightened her shoulders. And then what I actually do is I give her a quote. I say, did her thoughts run along these lines? The thousand injuries of Caucasians I had borne as I best could, but when they ventured upon insult, I vowed revenge. You who so well know the nature of my soul will not suppose, however, that I gave utterance to a threat. Those are actually words from Edgar Allan Poe, but I wanted to give that vengefulness to my mother. When she stepped onto the porch, there was nothing urgent or harsh in her manner. Girls, she said calmly but firmly, Margot and Denise are taking their naps. They won't be down to play, so you can go home. And they do, but they return the next week and the week after that. Each time, Mrs. Jefferson steps onto the porch and speaks the same words. Each time, they leave silently. After the third visit, they come no more. And within a year, they are gone forever. A wrong is unredressed when retribution overtakes its redresser. A wrong is equally unredressed when the avenger fails to make herself felt as such to him who has done the wrong. Now, so many years after, Mrs. Jefferson will look down, lower her voice, and end the tale thus, I was too intimidated to confront their mother. I can't bear to think of her intimidated. Of course you were, I rush in, though a police homeowners in the neighborhood were probably still doing playing clothes duty. Silence. I hated writing that. It broke my heart. When that was the first time I ever remember, it would have been in the 70s, she told me that story, hearing my mother confess to that kind of vulnerability or shame.
It was a hard passage to read because the reader has come to know your mother as this proud, accomplished, beautiful, and confident woman.
She always has, the one-liner that takes care of everything, in race, in manners, in girlhood, in life.
And it was such an elegant way to show that there's a pecking order that even the privileged class have to contend with, and that even your mother was subject to it. It was just heartbreaking. It was so trenchant and so powerful.
We were talking a moment ago about what parents pass on to children.
Exactly.
So, what in terms of anxieties or secret fears get passed on to one?
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Another thing that was striking for me about the book, I think particularly here on the Vineyard, there's so much privilege, and we talk about the access, and there's so much beauty. But I think that there is a price that we don't often talk about, that the kind of, Negroland refers to the black elite, the black bourgeois. There are many names.
Many, many names for it.
The colored 400. And
yes.
I think that there is a psychic pain that often comes with being the first or having to always be composed and mannered and thinking that you represent your race in every single thing you do. And I don't think we often talk about that psychic pain. Certainly we don't talk about it publicly. I would like for you to talk a little bit about that, if you will. I know you talk a little bit about it in your book.
Yeah,
you talk about,
I do.
Frankly, you're very candid. So can you talk a little bit about it here?
Yeah, I think it's a tricky business. One of the things I try to look at is is the treachery, the underside, if you will, of privilege. If, in fact, you know, something in your history, and certainly that's true of race history, is making clear to you that it isn't your birthright. You know, it could be taken away. You've done everything possible to earn it, but it could be receded. So, you know, the negotiations to have earned your privilege and to show that you do, you're also contending with the pride, sometimes excessive pride, known as snobbery. you're contending with that, with your sense of, and that can be a sense in which that runs the gamut from disdain to guilt. What separates you from the larger masses of unrewarded, shall we say, largely unrewarded Black people? What do you owe them? When I was growing up, there was this strange, I shouldn't say strange, there was this merging of the leadership role that many upper-class Blacks had genuinely taken. You know, people like Du Bois, you know, all these people who really from pre-slavery times had started schools and organizations who that really were helping the race. That would sometimes bleed into a somewhat self-serving belief that everything I do, every way that I advance privately is good for the race because right. It is, I'm a symbol. Right. And, you know, negotiating that is very, very tricky too. I would say, you know, personally, the need, particularly for a girl in my generation, yes, to be absolutely perfect. You know, a perfect model of a perfect lady that worked against the old stereotypes of the lascivious, unintelligent Black woman, you know, that was pretty lethal. thank God for, you know, that I was born when political movements, civil rights, Black power, feminism, gay rights, all helped crack that open.
Right, and you were able to kind of forge your own way.
So yeah, so there's always this sense that many narratives have already been written, predetermined, and that you essentially have to find your place in that script.
I want to talk a little bit about, one more question from me about writing. I know there are a few writers here, and then we will open it up to questions. You have in this, you've already quoted from Poe, there's Langston Hughes, Sexton, there's journalistic information, their cultural observations. This is in no way a linear memoir, and yet, you know, time progresses. How did you construct this? Did you sit down? I know you wanted to do something different.
Right.
We know that writing can be hard, and you wanted to challenge yourself. But did you know it was going to look like this when you sat down?
Initially, I had no idea what it was going to look like. So I thought, you know, because you read memoirs, you think about them, I thought, all right, let's try a strictly linear narrative and lots of neatly constructed little scenes. And it was absolutely going dead on the page. More importantly, it was going dead inside me. Mm-hmm. And I remembered, with the help of a few friends who reminded me, that when I did essays, and even when I did the Michael Jackson book, I really worked in a collage form. Even a review, it might start with, you know, a free associative quote, a piece of history, you know, then a description, and then only at the end would I really put it together. So I started working that way, really collage-like. And that's when I realized this is going to work. You know, like the different tenses and first, second, third person, this is true to the experience because it's fractured. Your moods, you know, there are constant mood shifts. You know, one time, you know, I'm talking about, you know, the legacy of, you know, of pain and guilt among the Black bourgeoisie, and then the next moment, you know, I'm saying, I was really happy in that grammar school, and that's true. You know?
Right.
So I really wanted to get at that. And once I was able to collage it, I had to recollage it a lot, you know, because it's always too internal at first. You know, you see the connectives, no one else does. But then I realized, okay, I'm home free. I found a quote from a poet named René Char, in which he spoke of, in a very sobering context, he spoke of the forced march to the fragmented outcome. Ooh, and I thought, yes,
that's a good
one. That's what I
write
want.
That down.
Yes. I put it on a card above my desk, actually.
Oh, I like that. I have more questions, but I'm sure that the audience does as well. So we're going to pass around microphones. And as you start contemplating your questions, maybe I'll... Anybody? Don't be shy.
Hello. I've just read the first chapter, and it's great. So I'm glad we're here. Not on? Okay.
There you go.
Hi. Well,
hello.
What I just said was most important. I've read the first chapter, and it's great. I'm glad we're here.
Thank you.
My question is, how much did you, when you write something like this, I could take an hour asking the question, but I won't. Who did you conceive of as the reader? Is this a bourgeois reader? Black bourgeois? Is it a white person? Is it a person from the ghetto? Who's the reader?
You know, it's a really good question, because that is something I have grappled with all my writing career. It became clear to me fairly early that I am always writing for haute bourgeois institutions, with majority white but not entirely white readership. Your voice can even change from, say, Newsweek to the old leftist Village Voice or The Nation. So I became very aware, and also as a young black woman critic in a world where there weren't very many, that, you know, I had a lot of different kinds of readers, many of whom were not always looking for the same thing from me if they knew who I was. So I have often in pieces even coded in certain messages, certain expressions, or certain observations that I know, say, you know, fierce feminists will get, or, you know, black readers will get, or whatever, or gay readers will get. I'm thinking of a piece I did about F. Scott Fitzgerald where I was trying to address all of that. I figured, and that's why in that first passage I read, I say, God, I'm kind of overwhelmed thinking of what different readers are going to want from me. I assumed that my readers would include every group you named, and some others. I was very aware that while I was writing about entirely, you know, really black-white relationships, in addition to the black world, you know, this world is full of, many of them are my students, South Asians, East Asians, Browns, you know, all sorts of people we designate as others. And I was curious as to what they would find that was familiar or unfamiliar in this book. So I was actually constantly wondering about who my audience was. I got a phone call once, because you mentioned... you said the word I think you used was ghetto. I got a phone call once when I did the Terry Gross show. I got an email after I did the show from a man who said, I am from Chicago. I haven't read your book yet. I did hear you speak on Terry Gross' show, and while it was very interesting, you didn't really talk very much about your snobbery, your group's snobbery. I remember very well how you used to treat and talk to people like me. I thought, okay. So I wrote a letter back. So, you know, the thing about your readers is, I'm making it sound as if, yes, I'm always navigating this. But navigating means sometimes you can feel a little paralyzed by it, because then you're, you know, too busy being watchful and guarded. But I do that variability, the tension of that, I have to accept as part of what I am as a writer.
There's a question.
It's great to see you.
It's great to see you, Ben.
You talked about your parents. Could you talk a little bit about your sister before you both went away to school and how you and she navigated this set of issues or this complex of issues together or separately and that relationship, as if you wouldn't mind?
With pleasure. I should say that Ben and my sister were in the same class at our grammar school and high school. So known each other since what, first grade, third grade? Yeah, forever. Okay. Denise, my sister was 3 years older. She was an extremely forceful personality who spent the last 20 years of her life as the director of the Alvin Ailey School. She had been very involved in dance and was wonderful. She came to, in Chicago, there were two private schools in our day that were accepting numbers of black students, Francis Parker and the University of Chicago Lab School. I came in kindergarten a year after Denise came in second grade. And, you know, she was, you worship your older sister in certain ways, even as you fiercely fight and struggle. So I was always watching her, trying to imitate. She felt when we got to high school that I was a little too all-American girl. one day she looked at me and she said, "You're so white preppy, Margot." So you know, we went our separate ways at some point. So we had our struggles. I tested out everything I wanted to become in those early girlhood years against what she seemed to me to be. Sometimes that meant I would have to become something else, but she was always, you know, that first dynamic, kinetic kind of model. Yeah, yeah. Isn't your first, this sounds too melodramatic, but in some ways your first both requited and unrequited love maybe for an older sibling, because they never pay quite as much attention to you as you pay to them.
Absolutely. Anybody else in the?
So I'm a nerd and I've been taking notes as you talked.
Whoa.
So I'm gonna sort of throw out my questions. My question is miasmic, I suppose. But you talk about the psychic pain of being representative.
Of
being representative.
Yeah.
And I've been thinking a lot about, I grew up in a family that is familiar, that your book resonates with me. And I wonder about the evolution of both the black beauty aesthetic, of what it looks like to celebrate black excellence in the world. You know, we live in a post-lemonade universe at this point. You know, Beyonce has evolved things, Barack Obama's evolved things.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I wonder what, I'm thinking about respectability politics, about old school talented tenthedness.
Yes, which is what this book is so much
exactly,
about.
Exactly, but how, you know, as a young black woman who has lived in a world that harkens back in many ways on some sides of my family to what you're speaking to, I struggle to reconcile the truths of your book with the fact that the world is coming to celebrate this blackness that was not what I was raised to, or that I experienced as what was righteous or right, or and so trying to put those two together to be black and excellent in 2016 as a young black woman. Do you have any thoughts about that?
Whoa. I think you want, you know, you began by citing, you know, people as varied as Beyonce and Barack Obama. The fact is, black excellence has many, many more, it's much more mutable, and it has many, many more faces and styles now. Black excellence would include Beyonce, Barack Obama, a black medievalist, you know, all manner of things. Black Lives Matter is part of Black Excellence. So you have, this younger generation has, my generation got the advantages, I think, the privileges of all the ruptures that civil rights going into Black Power, which then had to be amended by feminism because it was so masculinist, gay rights, etc. All those movements set huge things in motion, but they didn't. They sometimes had a kind of fixed vision that their descendants are pressing up against. So you have ways of defining and living out Black excellences that once that in earlier generations would have been considered everything from not excellent, that's not a proper profession. Well, for example, my sister in the Ailey School, she was told, oh, you will not go into dance until you get at least your master's degree. You can keep taking these lessons, but that's not a legitimate profession without a master's degree. This is not true. Thousands, so many things are possible for you. Everything from professions to styles of language to, again, a kind of mutability in your choices.
I think also in your book you show that you sometimes have to break away from whatever the establishment.
Whatever it itself, yes, whatever the designated establishment is.
Right.
Yes, I think that's absolutely right. And maybe you do it floridly and flamboyantly, or maybe you do it in the silence of your room, with reading and brooding and thinking, but you do it. Whatever the newest verbotens and insistences are, you ask about them, and you find a small, whatever group of people, of like-minded people, will help you be bold, will help you be brave.
There was a question here, and then there's one in the back.
I found your autobiography to be quite poetic. I was wondering whether you think about your childhood in sort of poetic, gentle terms, or whether there's more to be revealed, perhaps in Negro Land Volume 2.
I'm at the moment not planning any Volume 2. Who knows what the future will bring, but it won't happen next. I like that. I read a lot of poetry, so I like that you said that. And I was trying to blend a lot of forms, historical, narrative, lyric, scene making, drama. So I appreciate that.
Absolutely.
Hi, thank you so much. I was wondering if you
Where are you?
I'm right here.
Oh, there.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Thank you. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the historical research that you did for this project, and also whether any of the research, or through your research, whether you discovered that your memory was not perfect.
Yes. The touchy point for writers of memoir. Well, first I'll do the righteous, the research I did, yes. A lot, just a lot of historical stuff, because the whole first section of the book is really a kind of narrative history of the Black bourgeoisie. So I was going, I was going to Du Bois, I was going to Eric Foner, I was digging up a number of histories which exist of variously called Black bourgeoisie, colored elite, etc. I was going back to E. Franklin Frazer. I was finding primary sources, books that had been written by members of, it was called in the early days, the colored elite. I was doing all of that. I would really feel historically grounded, and that's why I supplied notes. Histories of the Negro Women's Club movement, autobiographies. There I was on solid ground. Histories of Chicago. I don't mean that I read every one of these books all the way through, but even of free Negroes who owned slaves, which some of you may know this from Edward P. Jones's book, The Known World, but there's documentation too, just to look at those class relationships. When I came to my own memories, first of all, once you're in the realm of dialogue, please. Some of it is just, it's recalled, and that means it's partly invented, because that's what memory does. You know, all of my dialogue is approximate and filtered entirely through my ear, you know, and my rendering of these characters as I knew them. And so, yes, some of it is invented. I have gotten corrected by several friends of mine about things that I misremembered. Yeah, they weren't enormous in terms of the substance of the story, but they were enough to, you know, in one case cause some irritation, and in another some embarrassment. So I made corrections. Memory is it's a combination of nonfiction narrative, a fact, interpretation, revision, and invention.
Is it on?
Ah, there you are. Yes. Yeah.
There are several things I want to talk to you about in front of everybody. first of all, thank you so much for engaging in the conversation that is just taking place in America. I call it race talk. Black people have always done race talk within the community or within our cultural groups, because things have to be processed and mm-hmm. things have to be kept out. There was a very controversial paper written in my profession in psychiatry back in the 60s that stated that black people had a split in their egos between worthfulness and worthlessness, and that split could not be fused. And therefore, most black people were not fixable. Now, that paper is still out there, it's still alive and well, and that attitude is still very much in force in some areas of our profession. The challenge for any parent or the challenge for any individual is to try and grow up and feel good about oneself and love oneself in this great country of ours called America. I'd like to know, because you've said many, many deep things in your book about your free associations, your thoughts, your this, your that. How do you feel that the challenge was met in turning out to be a happy, healthy, psychologically active black person in America?
The challenge was met for me. Me, you mean? I would not say, first of all, I accepted that one is not always happy, and that happiness, pure happiness, can be foolish or based on I'm trying to be truthful, because part of the book is also about my grappling with, you know, depression, mood swings, etc. I came to understand that those struggles, those are struggles that can be, that matter, they're worthy. They reveal things you are trying to grapple with that are worthwhile, that are meaningful, that show you are trying to grow. One's pain, one's discontent. Ralph Allison wrote in one of his essays years ago, decades ago, "Who wills to be a Negro? I do." And what he meant was that he accepted the beauties, and he wrote very beautifully about black culture and experience of that world, and also he accepted the struggle, because he could use it to think, to feel his way to new places forward. It didn't let him, and I tried to not let it make me settle into smug, easy, or strictly defensive ways. So It's in that way what any artist wants, right? Challenging material to make the most of.
I think we have time for one last question, though. That was such a beautiful answer.
It's very scary, thank you. My parents were not perfect, but they were deeply honorable and intelligent people also. So I don't have to look back on them with trauma, as many people of many races do.
I'm fortunate enough to have the microphone. One of the last questions asked you about your experience as a black person. You've referred several times about feminist and that influence. Could you talk about feminism from your perspective in terms of some of the universal challenges of women versus the peculiar or particular, in your case, personally as a black woman?
Black women, minority women, yeah. Well, I was born in 1947, so, you know, I was flung, my sister and I were flung right into that, you know, the 50s, the ideology that really came from Victorian womanhood had turned into perky American girlhood by the 50s, right? So there was not, the race mattered, and I write about this in the book. You know, civil rights was mattering. It was taking shape, form. There wasn't a women's movement. And, you know, these little organizations like the National Council for Negro Women or the League of Women Voters, they're so sweet. They were so nice and decorous and worthy and boring. That's what everybody thought, right? So there was no place. And yet, there all of us were, we little, bright, bourgeois girls, you go to good schools, you're going to do well in school, and then there's this other message, and you're going to meet attractive men in college, but you know, you certainly better do well. And young black women were also told, the world is much less dependable, so even though we want you to make a very good marriage, you must always have a career to fall back on, right? To fall back on. I got out of college in 68, and the women's movement was hitting within a year or two, and I was on my way to New York, again, following my sister, who was already there, being a dancer. I wanted to be a writer, and I met up with black and white, a blazing group of young women wanting to be writers, artists, social workers, activists, and together and apart, because black and white feminism were, I was one of the founders of National Black Feminist Organization. We were sometimes collaborating, and I certainly always had real friendships, but the organizations tended to move separately. We made our way. Those were the founding years of both those feminisms, and we've been struggling ever since. It's absolutely saved my life, period.
Well, thank you, Margot. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dawn.
She...
Thank you so much for coming. Yeah. Thank you.